Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. My name is Rod Cantrell. I'm the bursar of Fitzwilliam College. On behalf of the Master and the Fellows of the College, I would like to welcome you to the 2023 Wilson Lecture. The Inhabited Wall, Urban Fabric, How We Lost It and Why We Need It. The Wilson Lecture was established in recognition of the contribution of an honorary fellow and a benefactor of the college, Peter Wilson. And as I'm sure many of you know, Peter was the founder and editor of the Estates Gazette, a leading publication for real estate. He was also a really good friend of Fitzwilliam. Following Peter's death, his widow Audrey has played an important part in the promotion of land economy here in the college, supporting young scholars in their work, and latterly with the sponsorship of the Peter and Audrey Wilson Fellow in Land Economy. And I'm really pleased this evening that Audrey and her daughter have been able to join us for the lecture. As I hope you've noticed on your way in, tonight also marks the opening of a college exhibition in the foyer of the auditorium. The exhibition is constructed in two parts, the Lasden Years, curated by our college archivist, Dr. John Cleaver, and the Architects Table, curated by Allies and Morrison. It tells the story of 60 years of Fitzwilliam architecture and commemorates almost to the day the 60th anniversary of the completion of the first Lasden buildings on this site. So I hope you'll stay for a drink after the lecture and have a look at the exhibition. Now let me say a few words about our speaker, Bob Allies. Bob trained as an architect at the University of Edinburgh between 1971 and 77. He was a prestigious Rome scholar in architecture. He taught at the Department of Architecture here in Cambridge between 84 and 88. And he founded Allies and Morrison, a UK-based international architecture practice with Graham Morrison in 1984. He is chair of the Design Review, Design Southeast. He's chair of the Faculty of Architecture at the British School at Rome and a visiting professor at the University of Reading. Over the last 40 years, Allies and Morrison has included a range of award-winning buildings and undertaken a variety of master plans. The practice has received over 40 REBA awards. Closer to home, Allies and Morrison's work in Cambridge has been extensive. Projects include the Rosalind Franklin Building at Newnham College, the Girton College Archive, the Faculty of Institute and the Institute, the Faculty of English and the Institute of Criminology on the Sidgwick site, and more recently, Cranmer Road for King's College. The practice has also worked or is working on master plans for a number of Cambridge colleges, St. John's, Gonville and Caius, Girton and Trinity, as well as working with Marshalls on the development of the master plan for Cambridge East. Here at Fitzwilliam, Allies and Morrison have played a key role in shaping the design of our community. Tonight, I suspect you entered the college through Gatehouse Building, an Allies and Morrison design, and now you find yourself in our auditorium, an Allies and Morrison design. I'd like now to welcome Bob Allies. Thank you.
Thank you very much. First of all, just to say thank you, it's a great honor really to be able to give this, to be invited to give this lecture. It's particularly nice, I must say, to be giving a lecture in a building we've designed. I don't think I've ever done this before, so that's particularly intriguing. It's also a little bit daunting because there's quite a lot of you out there. Let's start. When Fitzwilliam's architect, Dennis Lasden, first set out his design for the college, he explained how he'd composed it out of two completely different types of building. A building that enclosed space and a building that stood in space. The buildings that stood in space, what Lasden referred to as the corporate elements of the college, with a chapel, the hall, and the original villa in whose grounds the college is set. These he treated as freestanding pavilions, or quasi-pavilions, standing within the gardens. The buildings that enclosed space were those which followed the perimeter of the site and contained all the residential accommodation. Laston explained his use of freestanding buildings as a deliberate move away from the familiar Cambridge model, in which halls and chapels were integrated into the building ranges that enclosed the courts. But his use of the residential perimeter building did the opposite. It placed Fitzwilliam firmly within the collegiate tradition, with its roots in the typology of the monastic cloister. The sense of enclosure that this arrangement provided was important to Laston. When describing his design, Laston characterized the perimeter residential building as a three-story inhabited wall, and explained that its role was, in his words, to define and contain the college community. It's the word that Rogers used in his introduction. And I think it's important that in Laston was making a space, but he was also making a community. For Fitzwilliam, the distinction between these two types of building, the building that encloses space and the building that stands in space, is therefore an important one. It's also an important one in the context of the city, and it's this that I want to talk about today. Because in the city, or at least in the traditional city, it is the building that encloses space, the inhabited wall, in Laston's parlance, that makes possible the generation of urban fabric. That is to say, the pattern of streets and squares, courtyards and passages that gives each city its unique structure and identity. And this is not just a metropolitan phenomenon. In his 1932 book, English Panorama, the town planner, Thomas Sharp, whose name will crop up once or twice this evening, observed admiringly how the nation's old villages expressed their communal purpose in the close and continuous character of their buildings, recording these villages in a series of meticulous freehand drawings. In 1951, the archaeologist Jacquetta Hawkes, in her book, The Land, coined the term rural urbanity to describe this same quality in the villages of the Cotswolds. Hawkes, incidentally, is significant in Cambridge as the first woman to study archaeology and anthropology here. But in the urbanism of the 20th century, it was the building that stood in space, the freestanding building, that became dominant. I'm sorry to say, these are pictures of Reading, which is where I grew up, but it seemed like a good place to start. And as a consequence, the fabric of our villages, towns, and cities began to unravel, and unraveled to such an extent that today, a large part of the work of practices like ours, both as architects and planners, involves recovering and repairing damaged urban fabric, putting the pieces of the city back together again. In this year's lecture, I want to talk about how and why this unraveling happened, why I think the creation of urban fabric is still essential to the making of successful places, and what we need to be wary of to avoid making the same mistakes again. But first, it might be helpful to set out three principles which guide the way the traditional city works. The first, as I've already suggested, is that in the traditional city, individual buildings don't stand alone. They coalesce to form a single matrix. This matrix is subdivided by corridors of movement, the streets and lanes, which provide access to every plot, creating what we somewhat unimaginatively call urban blocks. Typically in multiple ownership, these blocks rely for their resolution on the observance by all parties of long-standing and remarkably effective protocols. Of these, two in particular are important: party walls and building lines. The party wall is what, in an elegant paradox, both connects and divides one party from another. It's ensuring compatibility while facilitating difference. The building line is what establishes the relationship of the building to the street. The second principle is that within this matrix, every type of use can be accommodated. This, I realise when I put the slide up, it looks like three photos put side by side. It isn't. It's a building in Bath with a church, a shop, and a residential building just all in a single piece of the city. So every type of use can be accommodated. Housing, offices, workshops, warehouses, schools, town halls, libraries, hospitals, railway stations, and theatres. Public buildings sometimes stand apart in recognition of their civic significance. But even this gesture is unnecessary. Nolli's 18th century map of Rome famously showed how the city's churches, whose interiors you see, were all completely embedded within its fabric. A more contemporary example are the theatres in London's West End, which are all similarly subsumed, their plans simply distorting to fit the plots that they've been allocated. A last example, closer to home, are the colleges of Oxford and Cambridge, which Niklas Pevsner regarded as exemplary in the way they managed both to retain their internal logic and adjust to the complex pattern of the surrounding urban fabric. The third principle of the traditional city that I want to mention is that all buildings within the matrix have a responsibility to turn the corridors of movement into spaces. These may be simple or complex, regular or irregular, and the facades that enclose them may or may not be parallel. Not everything has to be a street. What is important is the facades are always considered not just as the outside face of a building, but as it were, as the inside face of an external room. In the city, corridors of movement naturally conform to a hierarchy, reflecting the different role that each is required to play. This, again, is something that design can reinforce. Hierarchies aren't always a good thing. But in the city, they have real value in helping people orientate. Fronts are different from backs. Together, these urban principles generate a certain kind of environment with certain familiar qualities. But they don't just create one type of place, nor are they only relevant to one type of context. They can invoke grandeur or convey intimacy. They can represent the civic or embody the domestic. They can follow rational rules, or they can embrace the picturesque. They are independent of scale, and they are also independent of density. Each era has offered new interpretations of their potential. The Bastide towns of southwest France, the Renaissance and Baroque piazzas of Rome, the concentric networks of streets and canals in the Netherlands, James Craig's Edinburgh Newtown, or London's Garden Squares. Such examples can be easily referenced because they're well known and because they're the outcome of a conscious process of design. But more interesting are the myriad situations where the relationship between building and street has evolved informally without the benefit of any overarching plan or explicit means of control. Cambridge, of course, is full of such places. Indeed, in many ways, it's the informal nature of the process by which urban fabric evolves that is its most intriguing aspect, co-design, we might call it today. To build a city requires cooperation from multiple different parties, different authorities, different landholders, different builders. It also relies on sharing. On the sharing of physical infrastructure, roads, utilities, services, and the sharing of abstract rules and standards. Sharing is fundamental to the origin and operation of any kind of settlement. Cities share access, rivers, harbors, transport corridors. Citizens share streets and pavements. Today we share bikes and electric scooters. Sharing is what makes settlements work. But even more importantly, at a time when we need to minimize our consumption of resources, settlements are what make sharing possible. A second significant characteristic of the traditional city is the notion of overlap, of the way in which any one component of the city has more than one function. The idea that one area, one neighborhood, one thoroughfare, or indeed one section of the ground might fulfill multiple purposes. A road is at once a movement corridor for people and vehicles, a distribution network for pipes and cables, a public space for interchange and encounter, and an interface for commercial activity. A city quarter, especially one in a 15-minute city, is composed of dwellings, but also offices and workshops, schools and hospitals. A neighborhood serves multiple communities. A park accommodates exercise and play, but also affords a prospect for the buildings that surround it. Such overlapping is not just a physical characteristic, it presumes an overlapping of responsibilities as well. And the third related characteristic of the traditional city is that of interdependence. It's not only the simultaneity of these various functions that's important, it's their symbiotic relationship, the way each one feeds and supports the other. The best example of this is the street. If a street provides an important connection, more people will use it, which will in turn improve the viability of the shops and cafes that face onto it, which will mean it is better overlooked, which will make it feel safer, which will encourage more people to use it, and so the virtuous circle repeats itself. This is what walkability means. But in the first half of the last century, the conventions and the principles of the traditional city began to be swept away, to be replaced, it was hoped, by a more beneficial type of urbanism, one in which the relationship between uses, between buildings, and between different forms of movement, and more broadly, the relationship between man and nature, would be entirely recast. More specifically, the assumption that buildings should habitually be conjoined to form an urban continuum, to create urban fabric, gave way to the belief that they should instead be broken apart. The principal reasons for this change are familiar to us all. Since the 19th century, this is actually from the 1940, City Manchester Plan. Since the 19th century, social reformers and politicians, doctors and engineers, architects and planners, had recognized that the city was failing to cope with the physical consequences of the Industrial Revolution, and more specifically, with the rapid urbanization that followed in its wake. Some went even further, seeing the state of the city as emblematic of the failure of industrial capitalism itself, whether in the dismal conditions in which the working classes were forced to live and work, or the decadent world inhabited by the bourgeoisie. There was also a more specific concern as to the ability of the city to cope with the proliferation of the motor car. The public's love affair with the car, and the motor vehicle more generally, was only going to grow, and towns and cities would inevitably have to adapt. But it would be wrong to suggest that the motor car was only seen as a problem. It was also regarded, in a late flowering of romanticism, as an agent of freedom, offering a means of escaping the city and establishing a new relationship with nature. As the recently arrived emigre architect, Eric Mendelssohn, excitedly observed in a lecture he gave to students at the University of California in 1942, great scale parkways are breaking up the depriving split between town and open country, integrating urban and rural life to a new organic harmony. Multi-lane highways are bridging sounds and gorges, changing the oppressive minimum space of crowded cities to the joyous romance of being lost in space. And it's important, I think, to remind ourselves that those in the vanguard of these changes shared an enormous sense of optimism, in the new possibilities, the new freedoms that were beginning to be identified. This from a publication by the Garden City Movement in 1913. In this country, there is hardly a district where we do not find landowners engaged in laying out estates or groups of individuals combining on co-partnership lines to start garden suburb schemes. Last year, 25 schemes were launched, providing for an ultimate population of 90,000 people who will be housed under the very best conditions. Or this from architects F.R.S. York and Colin Penn in 1939, 3 years after York and Breuer's Garden City of the Future model opened to the public at the Ideal Home Show, interestingly, in London. A town of the future could be a light and airy place, free from smoke, free from noise and congestion, with the country carried right into it. There will be no streets as we know them now, corridors with buildings on both sides. The buildings will be high so that they occupy relatively little ground, and a town will become a group of widely spaced buildings in a garden with extensive views from all the rooms. All planners now realize that our city streets, dividing the land into small, uneconomic blocks, are an obsolete conception. Or this historical perspective from Ludwig Hilbesheimer, colleague of Walter Gropius at the Bauhaus, and in 1944, head of the Department of Urban Planning at IIT in Chicago. Since the Gothic period, our spatial concepts have been moving steadily in the direction of greater freedom. We have become more and more concerned with widening and opening the city and merging it with open space. Today, our spatial feeling tends to openness, different forces to dissipate the confinement of the city, to liberate the house and with it man, and to link man to nature once again. And nobody made the case for a new engagement with nature more beguilingly than Le Corbusier, describing in the context of his plan for the Ville Radieuse, the modern home and the modern office. In the 1930s, even to the layman, the advantages of new ways of living, privacy, sunlight, clean air, proximity to nature, access to amenities, were beyond dispute. This is how the author Geoffrey Bunbury sums up the benefits of living in modern 10-story towers in his somewhat prosaically titled book, British Roads. Greater privacy, the nearest windows almost 100 yards away instead of 20. Better orientation, every available hour of direct sunlight on one face of the flat or the other. Freedom from noise and tram fumes, and an outlook over broad green spaces with full-sized trees and gardens kept up communally. The enjoyment of various communal advantages, cheap hot water, creches, gymnasia, swimming baths and paddling pools, workshops, libraries, properly equipped laundries, and so on. But all this came at a price. In the course of pursuing these aspirations, aspirations eerily similar to those we hold today, an enormous amount was lost, both narrowly in terms of areas of historic fabric cleared for redevelopment or destroyed by road schemes, and more widely in terms of the quality and utility of the fabric that replaced it. For almost inevitably, once the traditional city was no longer deemed of any value, architects, planners, and highway engineers all felt entitled, even obliged, to ignore the protocols that had previously shaped it. To a great extent, it was, ironically, the very qualities of the traditional city that I've highlighted, collaboration, overlap, and interdependence, and the sense of intensity and complexity which they generated, that caused 20th century planners and politicians so much worry. Instead of intensity and complexity, they saw only muddle and confusion, everything, everywhere, all at once. Their response, put simply, was to separate things out, to separate out uses, separate out buildings, and separate out movement. Some examples. In his famous plan for London, drawn up in the middle of the Second World War, Patrick Abercrombie showed how the chaos of 1940s Shoreditch could be brought under control, that's the chaos on the left, brought under control and all the disparate uses separated out into distinct areas. Promoted more widely at the end of the war in a government handbook on the redevelopment of central areas, it was a strategy that subsequently led to the principle of zoning, by which housing, once an integral part of the city's fabric, was separated out into housing estates, industry separated into industrial estates, shops into shopping centres, leisure into leisure centres, and civic functions into civic centres. In the 70s and 80s, these uses were displaced from town and city centres altogether. Offices to euphemistically named business parks, shops to retail parks, warehouses to industrial parks, while universities and hospitals withdrew to suburban campuses. With the aim of improving light and ventilation in the workplace, the same 1947 handbook also recommended that offices, rather than being incorporated into the urban fabric, should instead be separated out and designed as freestanding pavilions, the residual space around them being allocated to car parking. A similar approach was in due course taken to housing. A second post-war government document promoted the separation of through traffic from service traffic, encouraging the construction of inner ring roads with generous roundabouts introduced at junctions. Actually, ideally, they favoured flyovers, but acknowledged that these would in most cases be prohibitively expensive. To ensure the free flow of traffic, it was also recommended that buildings should not be allowed to front onto them. Cambridge emerged relatively, if not entirely, unscathed from the insertion of such road schemes, but hundreds of British towns and cities were irrevocably scarred as a consequence. The idea of separation was also essential to the planning of the country's first generation of new towns. As Frederick Gibberd, master planner of Harlow New Town, explained in 1948, the technical solutions to the problems that a new town for 60,000 people raises are now generally agreed, at least in broad outline. They consist in making a distinct separation between areas for work, homes and play, in connecting those areas by a road pattern free of building, in which traffic can flow easily, and in surrounding the whole by a well-defined agricultural belt. Gibberd also introduced green wedges to separate one area of housing from another, which indeed they did, often in retrospect, and I say this because my wife grew up there, to the inconvenience of the residents. One final example. Earlier in the century, the Garden City movement, with the aim of giving people greater access to sunlight and green space, made the case for abandoning the typology of the terraced house and instead constructing pairs or small groups of houses, each separate from the other. The idea of the villa, the individual family house standing in its own garden, was not new, but in the 20th century it became a nationwide aspiration. And this was not just a local infatuation. By 1913, the Garden Cities and Town Planning Association already boasted members from 13 European countries, as well as the USA, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and Japan. And while its first congress, held in London in 1920, had 150 attendees, by the end of the decade, when the congress moved first to Vienna, then to Paris, and finally to Rome, it attracted 1,000, 1,200, and 1,500 delegates, respectively. Crucially, one principal aim of the Garden City movement, limiting residential densities to 12 dwellings per acre, became enshrined in the 1919 Housing and Town Planning Act, which also set a minimum distance between dwellings of 70 feet, or just over These are the standards which determine the nature of the suburbs that spread out from British towns and cities between the wars, and what gave rise to the orthodoxy, almost ubiquitous in the second half of the last century, that densities should always be kept as low as possible. Now, in the face of a climate emergency, we're realizing that we need to be as efficient in the use of our use of land as we are with our natural resources, water, energy, and materials. Today, density is no longer a vice, but a virtue. If we live and work closer together, we consume less carbon when we travel, less energy for heating, and benefit from easier access to social amenities, which, because more people use them, will themselves be more viable. And because it shortens journey times and increases overlooking, density is also key to walkability, an essential prerequisite of sustainability. In truth, the urge to separate things out came not just from planners, but from architects, who increasingly wanted to remove their buildings from any engagement with the city's urban fabric. Unsurprisingly, perhaps, they saw little virtue in sustaining a structure which they and so many others regarded as irredeemably flawed. There was also a desire amongst architects to see if they could sidestep architectural traditions by deriving the form of a building exclusively from its own internal logic, whether that logic was functional, structural, geometric, or even in some cases spiritual or philosophical. Some saw that the plan of a building could be, or could appear to be, uniquely shaped by the patterns of use or movement that was required to accommodate, thereby embodying them and indeed representing them in an entirely new way. Others explored the potential of organic or crystalline geometries to generate entirely new forms. Such morphologies had the dual benefit of generating innovative and unexpected shapes, while at the same time seeming to have a basis in natural patterns and structures. They were thus both new and, through their relationship to nature, authentic. 60 years ago, the architectural historian Peter Collins traced the origins of this approach back to the model of the 19th century villa. The image on the right, fairly clear, a view of North Oxford, the village on the left, Bournemouth, and you can just about see the little dots, which are all the villas that were built in Bournemouth. Standing within its own territory, free of any external obligations, the villa offered an opportunity to develop architectural form with an unusual freedom. And as such, Collins concluded, it opened up a new architectural territory, one which we now associate with modernism. The romantic suburban villa, he wrote, was not so much a minor building type, characteristic of the early 19th century, as a paradigm for the architecture of the whole age, and by that he meant right up until the 1960s. A provocation of a very different kind, at once more definitive and more generic, was offered by the new structural discipline of the steel or concrete frame. This was another form of functionalism, one determined not by the use to which the building was to be put, but by the materials and components from which it was going to be assembled. Because of its fixed dimensional grid, the frame building tends always to want to detach itself from its surroundings. Adjusting to local particularities adds complexity and cost and undermines its architectural integrity. Separation is the natural default position, assimilation, and expensive inconvenience. The same is true of